Henry Wadsworth Longfellow, an American poet, once stated, "Music is the universal language of mankind." But what is music? Music is the sweet sound of harmony. It is the art of sound that expresses. It is a significant part of cultures around the world. Since prehistoric times, human beings have learned how to create sound. And the earliest forms of musical instruments, as archaeological evidence suggested, emerged as early as 43,000 years ago. And in time change, people change, and music circles change. Through times, modern music was distributed through the gramophone record, the cassette tape, and finally, the compact disc, or CD. The MP3 is an audio encoding format designed to greatly reduce the amount of data required to represent the music recording. Moreover, nowadays, with the help of the internet, music can be played through online media players, such as YouTube.com. Music has evolved over time and still continues to change. Forbes magazine identified the world today as an era of unprecedented musical abundance, when more music is being produced than ever, and consumers are spending more money on music than ever. People today spend lots of money in purchasing music. However, there is one artist who firmly believes that music should be free and available for everyone. She said, "Don't make people pay for the music, but let them." Her name is Amanda Palmer. Do you know Amanda Palmer?
No, I'm sorry. Don't know.
No.
Amanda McKinnon Gayman Plummer, or in short, Amanda Plummer, is an American singer, pianist, and artist. She was born on April 13, 1976. Her mother, a computer programmer, divorced her father and married her stepfather, a physicist. Amanda Plummer herself admitted that she was a trouble shy, and that her family was complicated. She and her parents were very different people. She loved art and metaphor, but her parents were factual and literal. They did not understand what art means to her, and that is why she couldn't get along so well with them. Plummer spent her high school year in Lexington High School, a public high school in Lexington, Massachusetts, where she wrote, directed, and performed in several drama productions. In her senior year, she wrote her masterpiece, a play entitled Asylum, which was inspired by her favorite rock album, of the same name by the band, the legendary Pink Dots. Plummer Asylum was selected to represent Lexington High at a regional drama competition. However, the play was disqualified because it was not considered a real theatrical work. It has almost no dialogue at all. Shortly afterward, however, Plummer received her first fan letter. After she graduated from Lexington High School, Plummer attended Wesleyan University, which is a private liberal arts institution in the United States that has the second largest number of undergraduates in liberal arts field. At that time, she did not have a band and did not even try to form one. As she preferred only rock and roll, she did not really like the musical course offered there, which were mostly non-rock and roll. Amanda herself admitted that she realized Wesley Young was a really fertile music scene, but she was missing it, because she, an introvert at that time, was too busy hiding.
5 years after graduating from Wesleyan University, Amanda Palmer found herself working as a self-employed living statue called the 8-Foot Bride as a day job. She would put a hat or a can in front of her,
and if anybody passes by to drop in some money, she would hand them a flower. She loves her job as a living statue because it allows her to connect with people, especially those who are in despair and hopelessness.
In addition to working as a living statue during the day, during nighttime, Palmer played music at nightclubs with her band, the Dresden Dolls, which she formed with a friend earlier in the year 2000. Meanwhile, she also toured around and performed music based on fans' requests. The internet and Twitter provided a medium for her to connect with her fans and build meaningful relationships with them. Fans can reach to her and request her performances, while she herself can also ask for help from them. For example, once she needed a piano to practice on, she asked for help from her fans, and one of them happened to have it. So Palmer was invited to practice at that fan's house. Moreover, fans often brought home-cooked food to feed her and her crew, showering them with warmth and friendship. Palmer often couch surfed, meaning she stayed overnight from one fan's house to another. She likes this art of asking, as she calls it, the random closeness that her fans are willing to help her. According to her experience, she believes that asking for help from fans really supports her, while many other artists think that asking makes them vulnerable.
The Dresden Dolls proved to be rather successful. Eventually, Palmer and her bandmate made enough money that she could quit being statue. Then, in 2003, Palmer signed a contract with Roadrunner Records, a subsidiary record company of Warner Brothers. During the time she was with the label, she released a total of 3 albums: The Dresden Dolls, Yes Virginia, and Who Killed Amanda Palmer.
At first, the label was supportive and promoted Palmer's band, spreading her fame. However, it had gradually reduced investment in her band, believing that the band was not profitable enough. It was during the release of her Leeds United music video in her 3rd album that she first got into conflict with the label. She claims that the label had wanted to edit images of her stomach in the video because they thought she looked fat. Palmer had strongly refused to edit the video, and the label had relented, leaving a bitter impression on both sides. Eventually, she requested for the label to drop their contract. Meanwhile, in response to Palmer's blog post about the dispute, her fans immediately rose up in defense, which is later known as the Rebellion Movement, by posting photographs of their stomachs and also sending them to Roadrunner, expressing their outrage of the label's superficiality. Then, Palmer was finally released from the contract in April 2010, and she immediately announced to the world with joy. After the contract was terminated, Palmer and her new band, the Grand Theft Orchestra, turned to Kickstarter.com, a website that supported crowdfunding for artists, to finance the promotion of her first album after her breakup with the label, Theater is Evil. The original goal of this crowdfunding project was only $100,000. But with the support of 24,883 fans, the total contribution sums up to nearly $1,200,000. This is the biggest music crowdfunding project as of today. However, Palmer was involved in a controversy related to this crowdfunding. People criticized her for asking for more help. Once she asked for local musicians to play with her band in exchange for food, tickets, and love, but not the money. Nevertheless, Palmer argued that those people don't truly understand the relationship
and the fair exchange happening between she and her fans.
Connection with her fans is what Amanda Palmer yearns for. This is her subject matter. One can clearly see this through her blogs and Twitter posts, which are frequently updated and shows her interactions with her fans.
Her blog, her website, and her Twitter account are her work, art, and stage. Because she is not under the record company, her social networking websites are like the stage where she can show her works. Through online media, she can connect with her fans and exchange opinions and thoughts. Her close and warm relationship with fans contradicts that of other popular artists who are untouchable, unapproachable to their fans.
On her website, amandapalmer.net, there are links for buying her works, donating to support her band, as well as the foundations and campaigns that she supports.
Palmer strongly believes that music should be free for everyone, and that audiences should support the artists by donating, so that artists could continue to create more music. In order to support her opinion, Palmer allows her music to be downloaded for free, while also offering the choice of paying. The underlying message of this option is, if you really love this band, then think about supporting it. Or if you're broke, take it for free now and pay for it later, when you have the money. Moreover, Palmer is outspoken about feminism and equality. She does not like the strict definition of how the society expects women to behave, nor does she like the restriction of what is good or bad for women and men. She believes that no matter who you are, everybody is equal. For example, she demonstrates her values through her unshaven armpits, shown in many of her photographs and music videos. Why do women have to shave them when men don't? And why does everyone say that women should? This is a message she is sending.
Furthermore, in her music style, Amanda Palmer's songs are dominantly about gender and identity awareness. Because she realizes the unfairness in gender, she chooses to convey her attitude through her songs.
For example, in her album, Amanda Palmer Goes Down Under, she appears to be playing with feminist issues in a song entitled A Map of Tasmania. Most importantly, Amanda Palmer sees a great conflict between art and capitalism. In an interview for a Danish documentary about the music industry of today, she noted that art and business are very difficult to combine beautifully. For example, the artist's work may have meaningful subject matters, but in the end, it will be embroiled in commerce and marketing, in which the profit, not the art's real values, is held with greatest importance. Therefore, the art created is not true art, but is rather a product of corporate capitalism. In the end, Amanda Palmer is a singer, a performer, and an artist who believes that music should be shared and appreciated by people, and that artists should let people pay for music, not make them. Palmer's stories may lead one to ponder the discrepancy between music as an art and music as an industry. What about you? What do you think?